G'day, Chris here and welcome back to Clickspring. In this video, I go through the process of making a set of screws to fasten the chapter ring to the inside of the bezel. My main priority with these screws is to make them look unobtrusive as they do the job of holding the chapter ring in place. They don't have to deal with a great deal of load, so a simple overhang of the screw head should be enough to do the job. But to make them look consistent with the bezel, I'm keeping the profile quite slim. There's also not a lot of depth in the bezel to drill and tap, so I need to keep the thread quite short too. So let's get started. The first step was to turn the basic profile of the screw. Next I formed the thread, and it was these bezel screws, as well as the other screws for this clock, that motivated me to make the tailstock die holder for my Sherline lathe. Click on the link if you'd like to watch the videos showing how that tool was made. The die holder keeps the die both on centerline and square with the work, making it much easier to consistently form a true thread. The ends of the screws need to be reduced a little in length and then domed, which is another great excuse to bring out the T-rest and do a little hand turning. With the thread complete, the next job is to form the screwdriver slot. The work was parted off a little over length and then rechucked the other way around. Now in a previous video I formed the screwdriver slots using a slitting saw on the mill, so in this video I thought I'd do it by hand using some fine cut files. For a small number of screws like this, I think it might even be quicker to do it this way rather than to set everything up on the mill. With the screwdriver slot formed, the head can now be trimmed to length, and I can get the screw prepared for heat treating. One of the things I'd like to avoid is the build-up of black scale that usually occurs during the heat treating process. So I'm enclosing the screws inside this small wire basket, and then I'm coating them in a mix of boric acid and denatured alcohol. The boric acid forms a protective coating over the metal and reduces the oxidation to a minimum. Once the screws have been quenched, that coating can either be chipped off or simply washed off with boiling water. Now the screws need to be tempered before I start the polishing, which means I need a fresh metal surface to monitor the colour change, so I took care of that on the lathe using this tailstock polishing tool. The temper colour I'm aiming for is blue, but at this stage I'm not overly concerned about the quality of the colour. I'll put a better quality blue on the surface as the last step after the screw has been polished. Okay, now for the part that certainly takes me the most time, the polishing. The screw was rechucked by its head, and of course initially it's running well off center. But I just love this attribute that lathes have, that with just a gentle touch, a part can be set to run true. It's so effective yet beautifully low tech. I started the polishing with oilstone paste on a piece of sharpened pegwood. A quick clean off with some paraffin, and then I followed up with some of this extra fine diamantine, also on pegwood. The screw was then reversed and the same process used on the top face. And again, I'm using the circular lap to make sure that I grind the face flat with crisp corners. I'm starting with oilstone paste on a mild steel lap. And then I followed up with diamantine on a tin lap for the final polish. The edge of the screw was treated in a similar way, first with emery paper, followed by diamantine on a brass polisher. I also brightened up the screwdriver slot with diamantine, and then gave the edges a very light bevel with a triangular shaped slipstone. So with all of the surfaces polished, the final step is to give the screw a nice blued appearance. As before, I'm using a butane torch and brass shavings, but this time I'm being a lot more careful about how the colour turns out. The screw surface is as clean as I can get it, and I'm keeping an eye out for any parts that change colour too rapidly. And that's the bezel screws complete. The bezel will need to have some pillars turned and then fitted at a later stage to enable it to be connected to the frame of the clock, but I'm going to leave that until later in the build. In the next video, I make a start on assembling the wheelwork. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later. If you enjoyed this video, then here's two more that I think you might like. And I do appreciate it when you give the video a thumbs up and leave me a comment. If you'd like to know when the next video is released, be sure to subscribe. And if you'd like to help support the creation of these videos, then head on over to the Clickspring Patreon page. Thanks again for watching. I'll catch you on the next video.